Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming this afternoon. My name is Vince Ferdile. I'm the Dean at the Albany Medical College, for those of you that I have not had the opportunity to meet. I'm also the Chair of the Selection Committee for the Albany Medical Center Prize in Medicine and Biomedical Research. Thank you for joining us this afternoon for a special panel discussion with our three distinguished recipients of this year's Albany Medical Center Prize in Medicine and Biomedical Research. They are being recognized, as you know, for their groundbreaking work on immunotherapy. Before we hear more about this revolutionary new treatment, let me begin by briefly introducing our eminent guests. Beginning at my far right, your left, is Dr. James Allison, who is chairman of the Department of Immunology at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, where he's also director of the Immunotherapy Platform, deputy director of the David H. Koch Center for Applied Studies in Genitourinary Cancer, and the Vivian L. Smith Distinguished Chair in Immunology. Dr. Allison received his bachelor's and doctorate degrees from the University of Texas at Austin and did his postdoctoral fellowships at the Scripps Clinic and Research Foundation. To Dr. Allison's left is Dr. Carl June, the Richard W. Vague Professor in Immunotherapy in the Department of Pathology and Laboratory Medicine at the Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania, where he's also the Director of the Center for Cellular Immunotherapies and Director of the Parker Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy. Dr. June is a graduate of the Naval Academy in Annapolis and Baylor College of Medicine in Houston. He received graduate training at the World Health Organization and did postdoctoral work at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center. And to my immediate right is Dr. Steven Rosenberg, who is chief of the surgical branch at the National Cancer Institute and foreign adjunct professor in cell therapy at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm. He received BA and MD degrees from the Johns Hopkins University and a PhD in biophysics from Harvard University. After completing his residency training in surgery in 1974 at the Peter Bent Brigham Hospital in Boston, the very next day he became the chief of surgery at the NCI, a position he has held ever since. I want to mention that all three of our guests have published about their work widely, and all are the recipients of major national and international prizes in science and medicine. Albany Prize programs are available and have more information about each of our guests. Their full profiles are also available on our website. Please join me in welcoming the recipients of 2018 Albany Med Prize in Medicine and Biomedical Research. Welcome. And now I'd like to turn things over to my colleague, Dr. Kate McNamara, who will be moderating this afternoon's discussion. Dr. McNamara is an associate professor in the Department of Immunology and Microbial Disease here at the college, where her research focuses on understanding how the hematopoietic system, that is the blood system, including all cells of the immune system, as well as red blood cells and platelets, is affected by infection and inflammation. Knowing how acute and chronic infections affect the system is important for understanding immunity and ultimately how blood pathologies such as anemia and cancer arise. Dr. McNamara?
Thank you very much, Dr. Verdile, and welcome everyone. I'm really honored to be here today to host this panel and to be with these pioneering scientists who have all graciously agreed to be here today to answer my questions, to answer many of your questions before the official ceremony that's happening tomorrow morning. So, immunotherapy, it's really a game changer, and in part due to the pioneering works from Drs. June, Dr. Allison, Dr. Rosenberg. So, what we're going to do today is talk about immunotherapy and get some insight on where the field is going. It's really thanks to their groundbreaking translational research in basic immunology that today we have innovative drugs like Keytruda and Opdivo and cell therapies like Kymriah and Yescarta. And these therapies have saved and extended the lives of tens of thousands of people. So today we really have an extraordinary opportunity to get some insight from the experts. And I certainly have some questions of my own, and I'm going to get started with those in a minute. But I'm going to open it up to the basically the entire audience here, and I'm really looking forward to hearing what the audience asks. So just to get started, I'd like to give a little bit of an overview of immunotherapy with your help. So Dr. Rosenberg, in the 80s, you theorized that T cells could be used to target diseases like cancer. I was hoping you could take a moment to describe how T cells function in immunotherapy and why they play such a central role, and how that ultimately led to the very first immunotherapy for cancer that was FDA approved.
Sure. So I began this work shortly after I went to the National Cancer Institute. And as the medical students and will appreciate in the audience, problems are constantly arising, questions are constantly arising from patients. And my interest in immunotherapy started with a patient that I saw when I was a junior resident in surgery at the Brigham Hospital. I was covering the emergency ward, and a patient came in who had right upper quadrant pain, looked like he had a gallbladder attack. I opened up his chart and began to read about an incredible story 12 years earlier. This patient, who was a 68-year-old veteran, had come into that emergency ward with abdominal pain. His x-rays had indicated a malignancy. He had been operated on. I went through the chart, turning the pages. His belly had been opened. He had had a cancer of the stomach, which was biopsy proven. He also had widespread disease throughout his abdomen, including in his liver. They biopsied the liver, metastatic deposit, could do nothing, closed him up, and gave him an appointment for 3 weeks later, figuring they'd probably not see him again. But sure enough, as I turned the pages, there he was. 3 months later, he was still there. 6 months later, he was gaining weight. A year later, he was back at his work. And here he was 12 years later with what appeared to be a gallbladder attack. It's one of the first operations I ever did as a surgical resident. And took out his gallbladder, but in examining his abdomen, all of his cancer had disappeared. We checked the pathology, that was real, it was exactly this patient. He'd undergone one of the most unusual events in all of medicine, and that is the spontaneous regression of a widespread cancer in the absence of therapy. I've never seen another one. Somehow his body had learned how to defeat the cancer. And so when I had a chance to get into the laboratory after my degree and went to the NCI, I began to work on trying to explain how the body itself, in the absence of therapy, could make a cancer disappear. And of all of the body's defenses, it's the immune system which protects us against foreign invaders. Now, in 1974, when I first got to the NCI and began this kind of work, there was no knowledge at all that, in fact, there was an immune response against cancer, that there was such a thing as a cancer antigen. There certainly were no immune stimulants that could mediate the regression of cancer. And it was in trying to figure out what happened to that patient, the question posed by that patient, that got me working on the immune system to see if we could actually reproduce that kind of cancer regression by stimulating the immune system. Now, there were no ways to deal with lymphocytes outside the body. If you took them outside the body, they would die within a couple of days. But as so often happens in science, a technological development can open entirely new directions of work, and the description of T-cell growth factor, interleukin-2, that could actually keep lymphocytes alive outside the body. And we hypothesized that perhaps just by stimulating the immune system, by just giving a T-cell growth factor, perhaps it would be T-cells that recognize the body as foreign and react against it. And so we began clinical trials, either creating cells by growing them in IL-2, these lymphokine-activated killer, nonspecific killer cells, part of the innate immune system, like natural killer cells. We tried giving those. We tried giving interleukin-2 on different schedules. And in 66 consecutive patients, and we published all of this, we saw no responses at all, and all of those patients with advanced metastatic cancer would go on to die of that disease. And it was only in the 67th patient, her name Linda Taylor, if she allows me to use her name, and it's been in news. We gave her IL-2 based on the pharmacokinetics of the drug, realizing that it had an alpha disappearance pharmacokinetics of about 7 minutes in the body and needed to be given quite repeatedly under a given schedule and at given doses. And Linda Taylor, who came to us with widespread melanoma, was the first patient ever to respond to interleukin-2, very likely the first patient to respond to an immunotherapy of any kind. And it was in the subsequent development of interleukin-2 that showed us that it was at least possible to use the immune system to cause a cancer to disappear. Until you see it once, you don't know it ever can happen. But once you know it can happen, well, then you have clues on how to proceed. And in fact, to answer your question, interleukin-2 then became more widely used and actually became the first immunotherapy ever approved by the Food and Drug Administration for the treatment of patients with metastatic kidney cancer in 1992, melanoma in 1998, and it was a study of what cells were resulting in the regression due to IL-2 that identified the T cell as the critical player, and our research went on from there.
Thank you. So, Dr. Allison, to follow up on T cells, you helped identify the receptor, the T cell receptor that recognizes antigens and the different signals that help it act as an ignition switch. So I was wondering if you could take a moment to explain the significance of that breakthrough and how that has come full circle to what we now refer to as checkpoint blockade therapy. Yeah. Okay. And which is now a mainstay in some therapies for certain types of cancer.
Well, I first became aware of T cells when I was an undergraduate, actually, in the 60s, just to date. T cells had just been discovered then. And my professor, I asked him, well, at least, he was an antibody guy, but, he said there are these things called T cells. I said, what do they do? And he said, they just go all over your body through your tissues and protect you against stuff. And I said, but how do they do that? And he said, nobody has a clue at that time. Nobody had a clue for many years as to what the structure that they used on their surface to recognize the whatever it was they were recognizing. And there were some clues as to how it worked, but not the actual molecule. Anyway, I just formed a hypothesis about what it should look like. I was trained in biochemistry, and I reasoned that on different T cells, and I use T cell tumors, that each one should have a unique structure that you could pick up by making antibodies that would react just with one tumor and not with any other ones. And it should be a structure that's on all T cells, but not B cells, and the overall structure. And that each, and then parts of it should be the same from cell to cell, and parts of it should be different. And so I found that, worked it all out, published it. I didn't have any functional data, but one of the most famous immunologists and T cell biologists at the time was Pippa Merrick, called me one day and said, we just saw your paper, and we have an antibody that stimulates T cells, and we repeated your experiment and got exactly the same molecule. And so that was the beginning of it. And then the genes were cloned by Mark Davis and Steve Hedrick about 5 years later, and things sort of went from there.
And then how T cell receptors actually function to turn that T cell on, and what modulates that? So to the checkpoint blockade.
Before
therapy.
We first got the receptor, everybody thought, well, you just, it's a light, like a light switch. You just turn something on, you just flip a switch and it goes on. But quickly it was realized that didn't happen like that. There was another signal called a co-stimulatory signal, or signal two, people insightfully called it. And it was known that dendritic cells, which had been discovered by the late Ralph Steinman, were the best sources of that costimulatory signal. They were also the best cells that initiated immune responses. Anyway, we just worked around a lot to show that the receptor for those signals on a T cell was a molecule called CD28. And its engagement was sufficient and necessary as a second signal along with the T cell receptor to fully activate a T cell. But that wasn't the end of the story at that point. One of the key things that we found then was that others found the ligands, these molecules called B7s. Anyway, tumor cells couldn't provide the costimulatory signal. And so, anyway, we put the B7 molecule into tumors and found out that they got rejected, which showed that they had antigens, but they were just invisible to the immune system because they weren't getting the right signals. Anyway, so we worked with that for a while, but when we cloned CD28, it turned out there was another molecule that had already been discovered, but its function was totally unknown. It was just known that it was expressed only after activation of T cells. Later it was shown that it actually binds to the same molecules as CD28, the B7 molecules, and it was structurally very similar to CD28. And a lot of people, of course, jumped on it and started studying. The first papers that came out said it was another costimulatory molecule, but we looked at it and realized that the experiments that were done, which was just putting an antibody to it and with that activated T cells, showed that they proliferated or whatever, made more IL-2. So it was thought to be another costimulatory molecule, but of course, you can't tell the difference between adding a positive signal and removing a negative signal. So we did several more experiments and showed conclusively that it was actually delivered a negative signal. And then putting that all together led to this idea that I had about checkpoint blockade, where the tumor is going around the body. It has antigens, it has things that the T cells can see, but it's invisible because it can't give that second signal until it gets big enough to start to die and cause inflammation. And then these dendritic cells come in to clean up part of the innate immune system. And then in the process of that, they pick up tumor bits, reprocess them, put it on the surface, and then that primes naive T cells, and then they can take off. But the idea was that the T cells had a head start because it's growing all this time until that event happens, and that CTLA-4 is going to turn the T cells off after a time, and it's just a race at that point. You've got to generate hundreds of thousands of cells to millions of cells in a week or so to really get an effective immune response. And so that happens, but you have to stop it. And CTLA-4's job is to stop it. Anyway, I just reason that if we just take the brakes off temporarily and let the T cells keep going as long as they needed to illuminate the tumor, that might work. And it was compelling for a couple of reasons. One is you're not treating the tumor, you're treating the immune system. The tumor has nothing to do with it, really. And so that being the case, it ought to work with all cancer types. We know now that that's not right. There are other things limited, of course. And the second one was that, chemotherapy, radiation, things like that, don't have the features of the immune system. They don't have memory. They don't have T cells. Once you've got them, stay with you for the rest of your life. They don't have the ability to recognize products of many mutations in a cell. The drugs that are directed to tumors usually recognize just one, and so the tumor could easily escape that. But the immune system could recognize many of them. And then finally, the immune system is adaptable and can change as the tumor changes. And so since the whole process is started by cell death and priming, you could give some of the properties of immunotherapy to chemotherapy or to genomically targeted therapies or to radiation by just doing combinations. And that's the way it's played out since then.
Thank you. And so now, Dr. June, So you work on chimeric antigen receptor T cells. Could you give a little bit of an overview of what these are and how they're being used for treating cancer as well as other diseases like HIV?
Sure. Chimeric antigen receptor cells are called CAR, C-A-R, T cells. So it's the same cell that Jim and Steve just talked about. They're cells that evolved in our body to fight viral infections. And they use that T cell receptor that Jim Allison just told you about to look at mutated molecules inside the cell. So if you get a viral infection, that puts new DNA or RNA in your cell, and the T cell receptor can sense that. But it does it with very low binding energy. So usually it only lasts for a second or two. And so it needs to be amplified. Those are the checkpoint therapies Jim was talking about. A CAR cell is a fusion of what an antibody is. And antibodies really work in our body to fight infections, but not from viral infections, but infections that are outside cells. So antibodies bind with high affinity. They can bind on for very long periods of time and don't let go. And so that's how we can neutralize tetanus, for instance, if you get tetanus and other infections. So a chimera, you know, is a Greek fusion between three species. And an antibody then normally is made by B cells, and the B cells put into the T cell. So that's a chimeric molecule then. The antibody of a B cell is in the T cell. So now the T cell has a way to bind with high affinity, and it's like, you know, teeth latching on from a pit bull, for instance, and it doesn't let go. That's, so it's very high affinity, and we can adjust that now by using, you know, recombinant engineering. So now you can potentially change the specificity of T cells to anything and not just what we grew up with. And against, you know, tumor antigens of choice. So it's different than using checkpoint therapies, which augment the immune system, our natural immune system. And as Jim said, that's host independent. I mean, it's tumor independent. It's just augmenting the immune system. With gene engineering, you can do what the new field is called a synthetic biology, and that's you know, put functions in cells that nature didn't evolve naturally. So a chimeric antigen receptor is a synthetic molecule that doesn't exist in the natural immune system. And there's going to be many kinds of this now because we have these exciting technologies of, you know, gene transfer and things like genetic editing that you heard about at this award last year, which is CRISPR engineering. So there's these things will go hand in glove by augmenting the natural immune system and then being able to genetically enhance it to tumor-specific targets.
Thank you. So for years, the standard of therapy for treating cancer has been surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation. And now that we're learning a lot more about how the immune system works, I was wondering if you could comment on, you know, I think you already have a little bit, but what's so special about the immune system, why it's so powerful, what are the advantages of immunotherapy over these more traditional methods? And do you foresee a time when they will be used as first treatments as opposed to sort of like second line after other treatments fail? So I don't know who would like to start, but okay.
So we have to put immunotherapy in perspective. American Cancer Society statistics told us that in the year 2017, just last year, 600,000 Americans died of cancer. Now, if you develop cancer in the year 2018, your chance of being cured of that disease is more than half. More than half of all people who develop cancer are cured, largely by surgery, by removing the primary lesion. It's only when the tumor has spread beyond that primary site that surgery can no longer be effective. And so we have systemic treatments like chemotherapy, which can slow down the growth of common solid cancers, but cannot get rid of them. There are no curative systemic therapies for virtually any common epithelial cancer. And so there's a desperate need for something to add to surgery, radiation therapy, which is another local treatment, and chemotherapy, and that's immunotherapy. And so immunotherapy can work alone. We've heard from Dr. June about CAR T cells, which can treat patients with leukemias and lymphomas. And the first patient we ever treated with lymphoma back in 2009 with CAR T cells is still alive now, 9 years later, had pounds of tumor in his belly. That can be a primary therapy, although it's now approved only when you've been through other standard treatments. Certainly the checkpoint modulators like anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1 that Dr. Allison was so instrumental in developing can be frontline treatments for certain kinds of diseases like metastatic melanoma. So I think they can be standalone, but I think we're also going to see the increasing use of these immunotherapies in conjunction with surgery, because there may be cells left behind that the surgeon hasn't removed and immunotherapy can clean up. Or one of the advantages of the cell therapies is that if you remove cells from the body, you now have an opportunity to alter the microenvironment in that patient by using chemotherapies or other drugs that in themselves might be immunosuppressive. So very hard to use those drugs when the immune system is intact. But once you take the immune cells out, you now have an opportunity to give chemotherapies without causing the immunodeficiency. Because the lymphocytes are out of the body, you can then educate them, genetically modify them, and give them back. So I think we've seen now what used to be a three-legged stool, which is a little unstable and couldn't cure many patients. Now we see a fourth leg to that stool, and that is immunotherapy. And it probably now represents the most exciting area of progress in all of oncology. Almost a third of all the cancer meetings now deal solely with new developments in immunotherapy.
Dr. Allison, Dr. June, do you have anything to add to that about?
In my own field, you know, I train in leukemia. There is, right now, as was said, if you get these cell therapies, it's at the end stage. You have to have progressed after at least two or three, as you were saying. And so the patient has already had a lot of chemotherapy and radiation. And I will tell you frankly that the medical system is quite conservative. You know, physicians who go through medical school get used to doing what they do. So you have to say, how soon will they be willing to change their practice to move things up front? Because the most efficient thing ever in medicine is a vaccine. You know, if you can treat early and prevent disease. So yeah. Where we want to go long term is preventing cancer in patients. And you know, right now we have ways to identify people at risk for familial cancers, such as breast and ovarian cancer. And I think that will be one area, is can we prevent it with upfront immunotherapy? But right now, what probably the most ethical way to do an experiment like this is actually in pediatric leukemia. So many children with leukemia get cured right now, but they get, it has a horrendous cost because it's radiation and chemotherapy. And it's not a cost financially, but it's to their IQ, which is on average 10 or 20 points lower. And their vertical growth is inches shorter because of the radiation. So, and then they get secondary tumors years later. So there's actually more side effects from chemotherapy and radiation in kids because they're trying to grow than there are in adults. So right now the Children's Oncology Group in the US is organizing a trial that will begin in kids and give them first line CAR T cells, you know, if they have high risk leukemia, and then compare that to the standard of chemotherapy and radiation. So yeah, it's actually faster than I would have thought.
So there are certain cancers that are right now deemed pretty treatable with current therapies, and so smaller percentage of patients that do have refractory disease that then go on to get CAR T-cell therapy or something like that. But you bring up a really interesting point, that all of those therapies actually do have a cost. So even if they're cured, it's at a high cost. Okay, so I'm actually going to take a little bit of a break and turn to the audience and see if we have some questions. I just would like to remind you to please use the microphones that should be around. Does anybody have a question that they would like to ask at this time?
Well, it's quite an honor, Dr. Rosenberg. I remember reading about your patient who was stage 4 melanoma cancer, completely recovered. I think even before I became a medical student. I was wondering what took you from surgery, now this is probably more of a personal question than about immunotherapy, but what took you from practice to the lab?
I always knew I wanted to be a doctor. Well, wanted to be a cowboy till I was 5, but after that. I always knew I wanted to be a doctor, and the more I learned about it, the more I became aware of how many medical problems had not been solved. And I grew up after the Holocaust and learned of all these terrible things that people had done to other people. And the combination of the things we couldn't accomplish in medicine and the disasters that had occurred during the Second World War led me to understand that what I wanted to do was to do things that were good for people, and knew from a very early age that I wanted to do research. And so immediately after finishing medical school, having done research during summers and when I could, I did an internship and then decided I needed a broader base of information, and went and got a Ph.D. Now, why biophysics? I studied the biophysics of cell membranes, but my purpose in going to medical school is, I think, the purpose of virtually all education, and that is to get you to lose your fear of what you do not know, so that you, in your education, gain a base of information in a given field that gives you the confidence that you can draw on many different areas of science, whether it's physics or quantum mechanics or differential equations or basic biology, that you could draw on any part of science and bring it to bear on the problems that that you're studying. And so I became a surgeon because I wanted to treat patients, and I also felt I needed access to the tissues to do the kind of research that I wanted to do. And so having gotten this PhD, I actually set a record at Harvard. It took me longer to finish my surgical residency than anybody previously. It was 11 years from the day I started my residency till the time that Franny Moore, the chief of surgery at Brigham, decided it was safe to let me out of there. But I immediately, given multiple opportunities, went to the National Cancer Institute, which is an institution which has a state-of-the-art hospital and huge research laboratories, but an institution that has a mandate not just to practice the best of today's medicine, but to create the best of tomorrow's medicine. And so I went to the NCI. I was fortunate enough to get appointed chief the day I finished my residency. That was 44 years ago, this July. And it's been an ideal place to combine medical care with research into the development of new treatments.
Do we have some more questions?
Thank you. I was just wondering if you could share with us what the near horizon of maybe the next iterations of the work you're doing, or future vision of applied immuno-oncology, and in particular challenges with solid tumors.
If I could talk about the checkpoint blockade, I think what we're realizing now is that by combining, there are several checkpoints that we have now. The two main ones are CTLA-4 and PD-1. And they can work together. With CTLA-4, there was a big follow-up of patients. It was approved by, in 2011 for the treatment of metastatic melanoma. There was a follow-up study about 3 years ago following 5,000 patients where there was 10 years follow-up, and 22% of the patients were alive 10 years after a single round of treatment with anti-CTLA-4. But then PD-1 came along, and it has a pretty good response rate, a little higher than that, some fewer adverse events. But if you put the two together, 60%, the response rate's about 60% in metastatic melanoma. And there's now follow-up data for about 3 years. And with the studies of anti-CTLA-4, the survival curve flattens out at 3 years and stays there for, like I said, for 10. And it looks like that may be happen for 60% of metastatic melanoma patients. Now, other kinds of cancers don't respond quite as well, but that combination works very well in many different kinds of cancer. But in some, like lung cancer, for example, you can use chemotherapy along with the checkpoint blockade to really initiate the priming, and particularly with like I said, PD-1 in lung cancer. There was a study presented at ASCO this June showing that was very effective. And I think that was recently approved by the FDA, or soon will be. But I think that's where the field is going, is combining. It's not that, I don't think immunotherapy is ever going to replace chemotherapy or radiation or surgery, but I think that it'll be a part of every surgery. There'll be combinations that are tailored to the kind of cancer that people have, with antibodies to the particular checkpoints that are important there. CTLA-4 and PD-1 are pretty universally expressed, but there are other ones, such as VISTA, that are variably expressed in different kinds of cancers. In prostate cancer, for example, you see VISTA. You don't see that in melanoma. You know, so we're learning how to look at the patient's tumor and make a personalized combination of checkpoint blockers plus chemotherapy or radiation or whatever, and really raise that response rate and the durable response rate up higher and higher. And I think that's the way it's going. Some remarkable things too with radiation and checkpoint blockade. So it's going to be combinations.
It looks like we have a question up there.
Okay, thank you for taking our questions. So we had touched on that therapies sometimes have negative side effects that we don't normally think about. Do we know of, or are there any theorized negative side effects of immunotherapy, or is it for the most part just like no harmful side effects?
I think we all wish that was the case. Unfortunately, with checkpoint blockade, there are a lot of itises, colitis, pneumonitis. They're mostly just a rampant, abnormal inflammatory responses that can be dealt with by systemic steroids. However, now that thousands and thousands and thousands of patients have been treated, it's clear that there are some true autoimmune syndromes that arise. About 1% or so of patients, particularly those that get the combinations, develop type 1 diabetes. And there's just a much smaller fraction that's just emerged of people that develop a T-cell mediated myocarditis. So the original hope, one of the reasons that immunotherapy was compelling as an idea back in the 60s was the thought that it would be perfectly clean. It would be just, perfectly leave your normal cells alone and affect the cancer cells or whatever. But unfortunately, it doesn't work out that way.
So yes, we know that.
Still better than anything else, though, probably.
Yes. So we know the immune system is really powerful. And so often we're walking a very fine line. And so there is this other syndrome called cytokine release syndrome, or CRS. So I was wondering if one of you would maybe explain exactly what that is and why it seems that some patients also experience very severe neurotoxicity. So this is primarily with CAR T-cell therapy. So
So cytokine release syndrome, or CRS, is what's called an on-target toxicity. And that means it's when we give the CAR T cells, when they kill cancer cells, they cause the cancer cells to die, and that releases dead DNA and other molecules that cause inflammation. The patient feels like they get the worst flu of their life. are, you know, both pediatrics and adults, we've had patients with temperatures of 106 or 107 degrees Fahrenheit. And but they don't die from that as long as it's managed appropriately. So, and in fact, if they don't get cytokine release syndrome, it usually means they're going to be one of the few who don't respond. So this is a toxicity, meaning on target. It's different than chemotherapy, which, for instance, causes, you know, your hair to fall out or mucositis and bleeding and so on. That's off-target toxicity because it's not related to helping you get better. And so patients do not like off-target toxicity, and I mentioned what it's actually worse in pediatric patients. So patients actually accept on-target toxicity if they know it's helping them get better. And we want to find ways to make it, you know, more tolerable. But to some extent, as Jim just implied, there's some part of no pain, no gain. With, I mean, if you have late-stage cancer with pounds of cancer, it's not realistic to expect it to go away with no side effects. Now, where we hope to go is to move these things up front, as we were talking about, and then we think it's an outpatient therapy. So, you know, it's a very early days in these, and in my own field, I started in bone marrow transplantation where one-third of the people used to die from side effects of the treatment. It was called graft versus host disease, and now it's 1%. So the medical field has learned how to manage that, and we're at the early days of this, so that I think it's going to get better. As you just heard, the Achilles heel of immunotherapy right now is probably this issue of will you get autoimmune disease. And right now, we don't have a way to predict who will get that and who won't.
Thank you. We have some more questions. One back there.
Thank you for coming. I grew up in the 1980s and learned about the immune system and its development. And I learned, and I remember this concept about immune surveillance. And my question for you is, has that concept gone away? Or do you feel like you're just unlocking with your novel immunotherapies something that's innate to our immune systems?
This concept of immunosurveillance, that is, there people are constantly getting cancers and the immune system is constantly eliminating them, was very popular back in the 1980s, early 1990s. But I think the evidence that exists tells us that that's very likely not the case. It may have some minor impact, but we know that mice, for example, that have their immune systems completely wiped out just don't get the common kinds of epithelial cancers that are the major killers in humans. And even immunosuppressed humans do not develop those kinds of cancers that are the major killers. So immunosurveillance may be part of the immune reaction against cancer, but I think a minor one. The major challenge that we now face in all of oncology, and that is, what do we do about the 550,000 patients every year that develop these common epithelial cancers that coat the lining of organs that cannot be cured by any available modality? And it's in that direction that I think immunotherapy is going to develop quite rapidly now, based largely on our new understanding of what it is the immune system recognizes in a cancer. I mean, a normal cell becomes a cancer because as the lining of these ducts, the cells that are constantly turning over in the body, most cells in the body do not divide, it's as they turn over, mistakes are made and as the DNA replicates, and those mistakes are mutations, and as you accumulate mutations, a normal cell becomes a cancer cell. Well, it turns out in the last several years, we finally learned what the immune system targets in a cancer, not strongly enough to get rid of it, unless manipulations are, such as the ones we're hearing about, are used. But it's the ability of T cells that can recognize antigens that we now know to be the very products of the mutations that caused the cancer in the first place. And so when we use checkpoint modulators, for example, as so elegantly studied by Dr. Allison, those inhibited cells, when they're uninhibited and can cause some cancer aggression, are very likely targeting the very mutation products that caused the cancer in the in the first place. I also have to say, sitting here, as to what an honor it is to be with such brilliant scientists as Jim Ellison and Carl June and the contributions that they have made. And my thanks to the Albany Medical Center for this.
I think I would give a slightly different answer to that, I think. In the 60s, the idea grew. It was championed by Lewis Thomas and McFarlane Burnett that the reason we have an immune system is to knock off tumor cells. I think that clearly is not correct. We have an immune system really to protect us against infectious agents, but by the very same process, it can protect us. I think the Bob Schreiber's animal evidence he's shown that some of the earlier work that said that the incidence of cancer wasn't any difference in mice without immune system, those mice weren't immune system free. They actually still had NK cells and other components. But Bob's work shows clearly that in strains of mice that have the ability to properly process some of the carcinogens like methylcalanthrin, they do get a variety of tumors. And he could show that you could treat mice and with low levels of carcinogens, wait a while, they don't have tumors, but if you deplete CD8 T cells, tumors come up immediately. There was in the paper the other day a study of a woman who had melanoma, I believe, when she was young and had been successfully treated and had a heart attack Anyway, she was an organ donor, and her kidneys went to people, and they were on immunosuppression. They immediately developed tumors that were from her. It could be shown genetically that it was from her. So I think there's lots of evidence that the immune system can do that. Now, obviously, it fails a lot, but at the end of the day, I don't think it matters because you can show that it does, can do it, even if you have to play tricks on it sometimes.
Okay, looks like we have another question up there.
Yes, thank you so much for coming. It really has been quite interesting listening to you. My question has to do with the heterogeneity of tumor cells and what you're thinking is if we treat, my assumption is they're heterogeneous and we treat certain subgroups of these tumors and antigens are recognized, and then a more virulent strain or a more aggressive form that is no longer recognized grows and then ultimately the patient succumbs. Is that a logical assumption, or what is your theory as to why once treated, or if treated repeatedly over time, the tumor continues to grow or there's a resurgence?
I think that's essentially correct. But the thing that happens, for example, when you use checkpoint therapy is you release the brakes on cells, which, as Steve explained, the T cells recognize the products of a lot of those mutations that are present in a cell. It seems ironic, but one of the reasons it's so hard to, and correct me if I'm wrong, treat melanoma is because it has so many mutations. You can throw a targeted drug and they'll always escape it eventually. But that makes them a sitting duck for immune therapy, particularly if you're just unleashing the T cells, because they can react with many different things. You give them a multivalent attack. And so, it's still a problem because they can still, there are ways. If it's been shown that in patients that become resistant to PD-1, for example, it's because a few things. One, the usual one is mutations in the gamma interferon signaling pathway. So they don't respond to the cytokines that T cells make. They can kill tumor cells. It's pretty rare, but there is one patient at least that has been found that had mutations in beta 2 microglobulin, so could not express antigens that were recognized by CD8 T cells anymore. So some of that could happen, but by getting this broad attack, by taking the brakes off, I think the more mutations, the better the therapy works.
And, you know, that's exactly right, I think. What we're now finding with very deep sequencing of tumors at single cell levels is, you know, you may have one tumor that's called colon cancer, but you may actually have subclonal mounts where it had a one founder mutation and then there's many subclones. And then those can later escape. And this has been shown for almost all cancers. My clinical colleagues who take care of lung cancer at the University of Pennsylvania tell me, you know, and it's really astonishing now that immunotherapy has become frontline for, you know, lung cancer with checkpoints. But what the clinicians say is basically you can do a cigarette count. And the more a patient has smoked, the better their chance, counterintuitively, the better their chance of responding. And that's because basically smoke being a carcinogen mutates DNA, and then they have more targets for the immune system to see. Now there's a lot of subclones there, but that is actually, it's unfortunate, that a smoker's lung cancer now is a better target than someone who never smoked.
I don't know if we want to promote that, but...
It's better
but keep
to
that,
not get the cancer.
Keep that one quiet.
You don't want to go out and get more sunburn when you get melanoma.
But your question gets to, you know, one of the major problems confronting immunotherapy, and that is, what are you targeting? And because cells grow and they spread and different clones can develop new mutations, and we know that the products of these mutations are the targets, it leads one to believe that one has to target many of these mutations at the same time, so that if one tumor subclone has down-regulated a particular mutation, a particular antigen, there will be other antigens on that cell that can be attacked in much the same way that you use multiple drugs to treat HIV infection and multiple chemotherapy agents that are used, so that by attacking different targets, you can overcome the heterogeneity of expression of any individual target.
Okay, we've got a question right here.
On the same idea, is it possible to induce homogeneous, like tumor antigen expression in order to enhance the immunotherapy?
Well, people have tried to do that. You can upregulate molecules on the cell surface with certain cytokines. The most prominently used one is interferon gamma. There are also chemotherapy agents, HDAC inhibitors, that can again unwind DNA and get expression of different molecules. But each of the drugs that have been studied to try to upregulate antigen expression are so toxic that you cannot get to the levels that in vitro models predict will upregulate antigens. And so that hasn't been a very useful approach.
Okay, so I was going to ask a couple of questions and we'll go back to the audience in just a minute. So one of the things I wanted to spend some time on is really the future of immunotherapy. So we've talked a little bit about that, but I wanted to get your insight as to where you really see the field going and what you're actually most excited about. So I guess we'll just start here and try to tell us one thing that you're really excited about seeing in the next few years.
So again, to emphasize, of the 600,000 deaths in the United States last year, 550,000 of them were the solid epithelial tumors. That is the big challenge. And I personally don't believe that CAR T cells are going to be able to attack these solid tumors, certainly not based on what we know now, because as you heard from Dr. June, it's based on the recognition of an antibody that recognizes the three-dimensional structure of a protein present on the and has to be present on the surface of a cell. And of course, antibodies can't get inside cells. So I think the major developments that are going to occur in the future are going to evolve from studies of the lymphocyte's own T cell receptor. And because we can now identify antigens, we can cancer antigens as mutations, we can identify the T cells that recognize them and the T cell receptors responsible for that recognition. And we can actually take those T cell receptors from one cell and put them into another cell. And so by trying to raise conventional T cell receptors against mutations on solid tumors, we essentially have a blueprint now for the first time that could potentially be capable of treating any cancer type. If you can develop T cell receptors that recognize these unique antigens and grow those particular cells at high levels, you should be able to treat common solid cancers. And so in 2013, we started that with melanoma, but in 2014, we published a paper where the first patient with a bile duct, a liver cancer, received cells against one of her own mutations. We developed this treatment by doing sequencing and identifying all the mutations in an individual cancer and using high-throughput immunologic techniques to identify the T cells that recognize them. And that's worked in a patient with bile duct, liver cancer. A patient with cervical cancer has been published, colon cancer targeting KRAS. And just a few months ago, we published a paper showing that you could use this in a patient with breast cancer. And so although response rates are low, about 15% by targeting these mutations with conventional T cells, I think that's the direction, certainly the direction that I'm spending all of my time studying now, and I think has the greatest possibilities for developing improved treatments.
Dr. June, could you comment on where you see CAR T-cell therapy going? So with this day and age where we can sequence tumors, we can use CRISPR to modify things, so do you see optimizing CAR T-cells even more? I was actually really fascinated by a recent report of a mutation that was identified that actually made CAR T-cells even better. So I was wondering if you could comment on that a little bit.
So, I agree with what Dr. Rosenberg just said, which is we're gonna see synthetic immunity, you know, genetically enhanced immune cells. That needs to be working hand in hand with precise diagnosis of the tumors, where its vulnerabilities are. And they're different, and just because it's called colon cancer, there's many different kinds. And so the targets won't be the same for everyone. You know, we, by looking at exceptional responders, we recently found a patient who we gave him a CAR T cell, and then we found, you know, people often ask, you give these immune cells and they divide in the patient. What's the dose of cells you need to give? And it turned out in that one patient, one cell cured him. You know, because that one cell divided about 30 times. And so you could do the math, 2 to the 30th, that's what he had in him. And what we found was when the CAR inserted its piece of DNA into the patient's T cell, it knocked out a gene that does epigenetic modification called TET2. And that led to enhanced function of that T cell. We've now shown that we can take normal donor T cells and reproduce that. So, you know, this guy is now 81 years old, but he had kind of a worn out immune system. And one of the issues we have is our population ages and health, heart disease has been taken care of, we actually have a cancer epidemic, which is what Dr. Rosenberg said. More people are living longer to get cancer, and one sort of glass ceiling issue we're going to have is that the immune system starts to flag, it doesn't work as well. Even all of us are over age 60, when you take an FDA-approved flu vaccine, it only works half the time in people above age 60. And so there's special vaccines now used for when the immune system's not as strong. And so we're gonna need to work on that. But we have the genetic technologies to do this. And finding the right targets is key to it, and then having an immune system, you know, where it's been really jazzed up for the time it needs to get to reject a tumor.
And Dr. Allison, in terms of checkpoint blockade therapy, what are you excited about? What are you really thinking about
First, I'm excited about the fact that it's been found to be broadly useful in many kinds of cancer. Excuse me, there are FDA approvals now in metastatic melanoma, pediatric melanoma, non-small cell lung cancer, small cell lung cancer, bladder cancer, kidney cancer, Merkel cell, Hodgkin's lymphoma. Anyway, it goes on and on. There's 28-something approvals now. What I'm not happy about is that the response rates in a lot of those is 20 to 50% or so, and we need to understand how to get that higher, and then also how to address tumors like pancreatic cancer and glioblastoma that haven't shown much response yet. But I think the good news is what we're finding, for example, is that if you go in and you get a baseline biopsy, that's not going to help you a lot in deciding what to do. But if you start treatment and you get an on-treatment biopsy, we know what a good signature looks like. We know what it looks like when it starts working. And you can figure out what's going on. For example, Bristol Myers Squibb with ipilimumab with N-acetyl-A4 had a number of really good responders for castrate-resistant prostate cancer. I mean, these guys were really sick, and they had a number of responders, but they failed a phase three because the response rate wasn't all that great. On the other hand, when they tried PD-1, it didn't work at all. Well, we went into patients, Pam Sharma, my wife, who's a GU oncologist, she went into patients that hadn't received any treatment and were getting prostatectomies, and showed that those tumors were really cold. They were a desert. There were basically no T cells in them. But she also had some patients that had gotten ipilimumab, and those were robustly infiltrated. They looked like melanoma at that point. The problem was they had upregulated PD-L1 on a lot of cells, not just the tumor cells, but on macrophages and the T cells themselves. And this other checkpoint called VISTA was also induced. So the first thing we did was went to, and Bristol Myers had canceled the prostate program. We went to them and gave the combination and had about a 28% response rate. We had CRs, people whose tumors went away, their Mets went away, their PSAs went to baseline. We're working on the toxicities there a little bit, but if we can't get that up high enough, then we could come in with VISTA. And I think this is where it's really going, is looking at just getting biopsies. I think right now there are almost 2,000 trials of checkpoint agents plus something, and usually that plus something is just picked because somebody thought it would work, with not necessarily any data. It might just be because a company owned two drugs and you put them together, let's see if these two work. Yeah, but they don't look, and if they don't work, they just move on, and they say, well, that failed, and you don't know why it failed. Bothers me that sort of stuff happens, but you should learn something from every patient that you treat or try to. It's otherwise you're wasting the patient, you're wasting your time. But the good news is I think we're beginning to get a grip on, as I said, what a good response looks like. And so you can go in with biopsies and say, we're missing this part. We need more M1 macrophages or whatever it is.
So yeah, just as a bit of a follow-up to that, and what do you think the role of basic research is in all of this?
It's absolutely essential.
So understanding exactly how these checkpoint blockade therapies are actually working, how do you think that is going to be important going forward?
Absolutely.
And what don't we know?
Well, in these trials that are failing, we don't know why they're failing. I mean, that's what I think is pretty much criminal. It shouldn't be going on. But we really don't understand yet why, glioblastoma doesn't respond. It's not just number of metastases. Number of mutations. It's not just mutational burden, because we did also in prostate cancer had patients that had 28 mutations, maybe 10 expressed ones, and the immune system picked up in one patient two of those mutations in a prostate cancer with a very small number of mutations. So it's not just low mutational burden, which is a problem with glioblastoma and pancreatic cancer, but there got to be something else going on there that we just don't have a grip on yet.
Right, some checkpoints that we just don't know about yet. Okay, so I'd like to ask the audience for some more questions. Yeah?
Follow up on that importance of basic research. So much of progress in translating science is based on basic research findings. It's new technology that drives applied progress. And so, for example, in our targeting of the particular mutations on a cancer that can cause complete regressions in isolated patients, what we do is we take out a tumor, we do whole exome sequencing on that tumor and on normal cells so that we know the entire sequence of all expressed genes and can identify all of the mutations. Now, that takes now 8 to 10 days. As you know, it took 10 years and $2 billion to sequence a whole human genome. Now, in my lab and in labs across the country, with modern equipment from Illumina and other companies, you can do whole exome sequencing and identify the entire sequence of expressed genes and normal cells and identify all mutations in less than 2 weeks, which then gives you the targets that you can then apply your therapies to. And so it was the sequencing of the human genome and all of the new technologies involved in that basic research that led to the applications, some of the applications we're talking about.
Okay, there are some hands up here. Okay, maybe right down here.
Hi, I was wondering, in the research of immunotherapies and cancer in general, I found that mice models tend to be pretty prominent. And I was wondering if any of you have had any experiences with issues, possibility of like differences in immune systems between mice and humans, or the issue of like needing to wipe out the immune systems for things like human xenografts, and how that impacts research of immunotherapies.
Well, there are definitely differences between the immune system, but I think we know what they are and how to get around them or how to factor them into interpreting data. I think that my own feeling of animal models is they're really essential, but they only go so far. You can learn about basic concepts and things, but to extrapolate from mouse melanoma, you know, the B16 melanoma is nothing like human melanoma whatsoever. And you down to the, when you start talking about particular histotypes of cancer, the mouse models aren't very good at that, for sure. But for just working out basic mechanisms, they're still very important. Xenografts, I think, are not especially useful in the sort of things that we do. Nobody's found a way of putting a human immune system reliably into a mouse yet, so, you know, for these drugs. And that brings up another point, is that one of the really promising things I think that could come around now is using these genomically targeted drugs that are found through sequencing and finding enzymes that inhibit them, like a BRAF inhibitor for treating melanoma. That could be a pretty effective vaccine, I think, under some conditions. But these drugs also have impact on the immune system. They've only been tested in xenografts, so nobody has a clue as to what these things do to the immune system. And so it's completely terra incognita. We found that actually, contrary to what the real fear was, that this small molecule that targets a mutation in the BRAF molecule wasn't neutral, neither was it immunosuppressive. It actually enhanced T cell activity through supercharging the MAP kinase pathway, which is used by T cells during expansion. You know, but you don't know that unless you look. And so this is an area that, like I said, there's just no knowledge of what any of those things do to the immune system, and that needs to be an area of investigation.
And I would just add to what you heard from Jim on the animal models. I mean, In the U.S., we're required by the Helsinki Accord to do preclinical models before you can start a human trial. So we have, and so mouse models are usually done. They have the limitations that you just heard about. There are being better and better models that are now engineered. And I think the real limitation right now is we don't have enough emphasis. When companies do trials, they oftentimes want to just kind of look at the bottom line and don't do intensive analysis to figure out why the trial failed or not. And then and if you can learn that, then you can go back to a model and then figure out how to work around that. So what we need now is enhanced research where we pay to get biopsies. So we can get drugs for patients on trials, but it's very hard to get companies to pay for the biopsies because they have to go to an operating room oftentimes, and that's expensive, and they won't pay for that part. And it's really unethical to do trials unless you find out and study those patients intensively.
But you can learn a lot from doing 10 patients, which is what we do. We're involved in 100. The group that Dr. Sharma and I run is involved right now in 117 trials that we're getting specimens, blood and matched biopsy material from 10 or 20 patients on each of those trials and trying to understand what's going on. With that goal, we call it reverse translation. Take it so back you can to put, mice.
You can put 10 mice in a cage and treat them one way, and 10 in another cage and treat them a different way, and learn a lot in controlled experiments. You obviously cannot do that in people, but you can do clinical trials, which can take long periods of time. And if you have something extraordinarily effective, maybe even 10 patients can teach you. But the other approach that we've used a lot in humans as a way to learn things in a controlled way is to apply a treatment. If it doesn't work, make a single change in that treatment and try it again. And if it then does work, you have learned something from just a single patient. And in fact, that's how we learned that when you transfer cells to patients that have anti-tumor activity, you can increase their activity dramatically by first wiping out the patient's immune system, which is what's standardly done in the use of T-cell therapy or even CAR T-cell therapy. And we learned that by treating a patient, a particular patient. I remember this young boy quite well, a 19-year-old boy who we treated. He had widespread cancer, did not respond to cell therapy. We then gave him a lympho-depleting chemotherapy to wipe out his normal lymphocytes, retreated him again, and he had a complete response of his melanoma that lasted about 4 years. And it was that as an example of a principle that is now widely used in cell therapy, and that is you first have to eliminate the regulatory T cells, the myeloid-derived suppressor cells, the endogenous lymphocytes that compete for cytokines like IL-7 and IL-15 that stimulate the cells that you administer. So by making individual changes and retreating a patient, one can learn a lot as well.
Okay, I think we have time for a few more questions. Go ahead.
Do CAR T cells, can CAR T cells become memory T cells and provide some immunological memory to the patient? And if so, would that be an important aspect when designing CAR T cells?
We've been studying that, and so our information is limited now to B cell tumors like acute and chronic leukemia and myeloma. So in bone marrow tumors, we have data that the cells, they have, very different than a standard drug you give where it gets metabolized away. We found that CAR T cells expand and with a constant time of point expansion of 0.78 days. So their doubling time is 0.78. And then they have an alpha and a beta decay, of which the initial alpha decay is 4 days. And the beta decay is over 220 days. So our first patient we ever treated was in July of 2010. And 7 years later, he still has CAR T cells that are, as you said, memory CAR T cells. So we think that in some tumors, that has a role in immunosurveillance and preventing the tumor from coming back. And because that correlates in acute leukemia with relapse-free survival. In diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, it does not. It looks like there, in just a few months, the patient can be cured and every last tumor cell's gone. So it's gonna, I think, become tumor specific on, you know, we probably do in general want memory. I mean, that's a major principle of the immune system. And when you give checkpoint therapies, you augment memory and you expand the, you give more effector fighter cells as well. So, and we know that from infectious disease, that effective vaccines are ones that, you know, make memory T cells. A
couple more questions over here. Dr. Lennartz.
So you've been talking about the adaptive immune system a lot, the T cells, CAR T, PD-1, and lymphocytes. Do you see a role, there was one brief mention of dendritic cells earlier, do you see a role for the innate immune system, the neutrophils, the monocyte, macrophages, basophils in immunotherapy?
There certainly is a lot of work going on in that field. Dendritic cells themselves have no effector function, but are common antigen-presenting cells and are being studied in vaccines. Now, right now, we don't have any effective therapeutic vaccines, but there's a lot of work going on with dendritic cells as a way to try to immunize against these cancer antigens. Now, when it comes to some of the hematologic cancers, there's some evidence from bone marrow transplantation that if you mismatch NK KIRs, that is, NK cells can play a role in the curative potential of bone marrow transplantation, but I'm not aware of any data right now that the innate immune system, not the adaptive immune system, which learns by virtue of exposure to the antigen, if there's any role right now for the innate immune system in the treatment of human cancer. But a lot of work going on, and who knows what's going to come up tomorrow.
But what about tumor-associated macrophages and simultaneously targeting the microenvironment of the tumor, sort of to...
Well, you know, these immunotherapies, especially you've heard from Carl about one cell curing a patient. We've been giving T cells that can cure a variety of different cancer types. They don't work necessarily by one lymphocyte killing one tumor cell, which of course can occur. And we know T cells can move around and kill more than one T cell. But in fact, it's the ability of the T cells, when they recognize their antigen, to produce cytokines like interferon gamma, which used to be called macrophage activation factor. Cytokines that bring in other effector cells that can contribute to elimination of the cancer. So I think in that sense, these innate effectors can play a role, but probably not a primary role.
In checkpoint blockade, myeloid cells definitely play a role in it. We can see that when we get successful, one of the features of a successful therapy is that the ratio of what are so-called M1 macrophages, which, you know, can help kill things, you know, they go up and the M2s go down. If the M2's higher, the therapy doesn't work quite as well, and you can shift that. Well, there's a lot of effort going on now towards trying to change, you know, and on purpose transform the cells from one type to another. So they're not the whole game, but they're definitely playing a very important role.
I think we have time for just a couple more questions. Dr.
So we've been talking a lot about these approaches and the success in treating cancer. And I'm going to go out on a limb here and ask about other areas of where these approaches might be useful. And I'm particularly wondering about chronic infectious diseases. Is the field thinking about applying these approaches to something like that?
Yeah, absolutely. There's some studies beginning with PD-1 therapy and chronic virus infections right now.
And what about CAR T cells?
And we have trials with engineered T cells in HIV. And in fact, there's, you know, 40 million people in the U.S. in the world have been infected with HIV, but only one's ever been cured. And that was you know, a patient who had a bone marrow transplant, and, you know, he got donor T cells, and there's data that the immune system is maybe the one way to really affect a cure in HIV where they don't have to take medicine every day. So there are a few trials now underway looking at that, and I think because now cancer immunotherapy has been shown and accepted to be successful, that we're going to see it go two ways. One is chronic infections, where they can't be controlled by standard approach as well, and there's no curative approach. And another will actually be autoimmunity and organ transplants. So there are very interesting trials underway now giving regulatory T cells to, for instance, treat active autoimmune disease or prevent, say, rejection of, you know, transplanted organs and not have to have lifelong immunosuppression. So I think they're going to kind of surf behind the success of cancer immunotherapy.
Any work being done on latent TB?
Well, that's a great question. We were talking before. You know, what correlates, I think, with, you know, TB control are, you know, macrophage, you know, containing, you know, granulomas. And I think, so right now there is a small company just starting at the University of Pennsylvania from one of my graduate students. I'm not involved, but it's a, you know, macrophage is killed by ingesting phagocytosine rather than killing with granzymes and so on and perforins that T cells do. And so macrophages they can be genetically modified, and I think that could be very useful for intracellular infections, for instance, that the immune system otherwise has trouble with.
That's very fascinating. So I think I can take maybe one more question. Who's going to be the last one? Okay, one quick question right up here.
Thank you very much for being here. This has been riveting as somebody who's does not have a medical background. I'm curious as to what role this therapy might play or what you have discovered in terms of prevention.
So that's, you know, there was the hope that there would be particular markers that represented antigens that one could immunize against in the way we immunize against infectious disease. Now, it turns out we can prevent some cancers that are caused by viruses, of course. You get rid of hepatitis B virus or C, you can reduce the incidence of hepatocellular cancer dramatically. Certainly, targeting human papillomavirus can prevent cervical cancer and certain kinds of head and neck cancers. But when it comes to the major killers, the solid cancers, every cancer has a different antigen. So when we studied 72 consecutive patients with gastrointestinal cancer and could raise T cells against 80% in the cancers in 80% of those patients, every one of the 72 patients was recognizing something different on their cancer that was not present on other people's cancers. That is, the mutations that occur in the DNA are so vast in number that there's very little sharing. And so the hope that one could have one target that could prevent cancers, I think now seems unlikely to be the case.
So just a little follow-up, what about things like MDS or myelodysplastic disease where it's before there's full-blown cancer? Do you see any role for checkpoint therapy or something like that that could be given to patients before they become really ill?
Yeah, that very thing is being tried now in a number of laboratories, actually. So.
Right, spot on.
You got it.
Okay, so I actually would like to take a moment to thank you again very much for being here. Appreciate your time and sharing your insight. So please, let's give them another round of applause. And And I'd actually also really just like to thank you all for being here and for bringing some really insightful questions. So thank you so much.